and welcome to Managing Money with Money Control. I'm Sakshi Batra. Well, to begin with, yes, wishing all of you wonderful children and the parents out there a very happy Children's Day. Now, since we are celebrating the 14th of November, it's perhaps a good time to really focus on your child's financial future. Do you have a plan in place that will really give your child the freedom to follow his or her dreams? Have you worked out educational costs or perhaps even wedding expenses that will stare at you a couple of years down the line? Well, if you haven't figured all of this out, worry not, because today on this show to help us navigate through all of this is Mr. Tanveer Alam. He's the CEO of Finkatch.com, and he's here to really share with us how should really parents really plan about their child's financial future. Thanks a lot, Mr. Tanveer Alam, for joining us on Money Control. Well, first up, I'd like to really understand what is the first main question in all the parents' life, and that is, when should they really start investing for their child's future? And how should they really set their goals as well?
Okay, the first thing that you should do when your child is born, you should start investing from that particular month or a couple months down the line. The reason is simple. If you look at education as a cost, that is one of the fastest cost inflation that is happening in the country today. It's at almost 12% plus. Now, given that cost, even if you assume that a 12% inflation is there and your child is born now, what we call is something called power of 72, rule of 72. 72 divided by 12% means every 6 years the cost is going to double. Now, take for example, even if you're trying an engineering college today, which currently cost approximately 20 lakhs, after 6 years, it becomes 40. When a child turns 12, it becomes 80. At 18, when he will need that money, it will be approximately 1.6 crores. If we have an inflation of 12%. Now, that is a humongous sum to plan for. Most of us do not tend to visualize that cost. So if you start early by saving a small amount of 10,000 also for a period of 18 years, you would be able to very easily fund that goal.
Right.
But if you leave it for later part of the year, then you'll struggle a lot to even meet the simple goal as children education. The choice is yours.
Absolutely. Next comes the question of where should parents really invest for their children. Now, there are a whole lot of child plans, endowment plans, ULIPs, you have mutual funds which are specially catered to the children as well. So, out of all these, how should parents really decide where should be they be putting their money?
Okay. Mutual fund is a good way of investing. So, when you're looking at mutual fund as a product, okay, so it depends upon how old is your child. If a child is, say, just very young and you have more than 10 years left for higher education, then an equity fund would be a good option to invest.
Okay.
But if you have a child who is just about 5-6 years going to class 12, then a balanced fund would be a good approach.
Okay.
Now, but if you have missed the bus and your child is already 15-16, in 2-3 years down the line, you might need the money, then a safe and secure debt fund would be a better way of investing.
Yeah.
This is from mutual fund perspective. Now, you can look at some ULIPs also, depending upon at what age is your child at. So it could be, but ULIP comes with a 5-year compulsion period of holding. If your child is anywhere below 13 or 10, then it makes good sense to invest in ULIP product.
Right.
But you have to be very, very careful that you only pick the ULIP plans, what is called the new age ULIP, where the charges are very, very low.
Right.
And what are the four kind of charges that you'll have to look at? Premium allocation charge, policy administration charge, mortality charge, the insurance you get, and the last, that you have fund management charge. So in a good ULIP, the premium allocation charge and the policy administration charge, they are both zero.
Right.
Okay. So technically, you are paying a low cost ULIP. Unfortunately, a lot of the children plans in the insurance world do not qualify in that segment.
Right.
So hence, I would suggest mutual fund and zero cost ULIP as a plan for children education. The third product that you have is Sukanya Samriddhi scheme for your female child, which allows you tax benefit as well. So these are three good products to invest to help you fund your child's higher education.
Right. I'd also like to ask you about the other asset classes. Say, for example, real estate. If parents want to invest in a land or a flat or, you know, a house, which the child can use when he or she is old enough. Also, a gold. Some of the parents really buy gold jewelry for marriage purposes as well. So, how prudent is it to really invest in gold jewelry? And what do you think of the traditional methods of investing in, say, PPF or FD?
Okay. These three products I'll cover separately.
Yeah.
See, real estate as a product is an investment. In India, it is a difficult product because it's come with its own challenges of not being very liquid.
Yeah.
So in today's market, when the real estate is passing through a bad time and you really want the money, you will find it difficult to sell it.
Sure.
So tagging it to a goal of a children education could be a very risky phenomena because when you need the money, you may not get it.
Right.
One. So real estate is not a great way to invest in for children education. Gold. On a simple phenomena, there are two phenomena to it. One is, whenever there will be a turmoil in the world, or world is passing through a crisis, the gold prices will go up.
Yeah.
Which happened in 2008 also. And if you look at gold, recently zoomed up because the world over, there was a slowdown, economic slowdown the world is expecting. So any kind of slowdown, when you find confusing whether to invest in equity and debt, money flows into gold and that is why gold goes up.
Right, right, right.
But having said that, gold for your children's education or marriage should be like a pickle in the thali, but not the main course. You have to be cognizant of that fact.
Absolutely. There's one important question that I really have for you. There are lots of parents who have special children with special needs. How should one really cater to their needs and their future goals? Is it different from when you plan for a child who's, you know, normal child versus a special child? How do you really differentiate with the kind of planning when you're planning your finances for those children?
It's a very good question. Yes, the planning for a special child is absolutely different. So before we start, you have to understand what is the nature of the disability. It's temporary, partial, or permanent.
Right.
Now, if it's permanent disability, again, it could be a physical disability or it could be a mental related disability. So the planning has to be very, very different. So if it's a serious permanent disability, then you are technically funding two retirement plans, one for your own self and one for your retarded child or a disabled child.
Yeah.
Now, not only the current expenditure, the budgeting has to be far more robust because apart from the normal budgeting that it has to factor the therapy cost, extra treatment cost. So it requires a lot of thorough budget planning there. Two, as a parent, you will have to take the top highest amount of term insurance that you can have because God forbid, see, you can support the child during your earning years with your earning.
Right.
But for any reason, you have a problem and you are not there, then that money should be able to fund your children.
Absolutely.
Third and more critical part is that you must have a trust created or a will. Ideally, a trust created where you have a trustee, which could be as a relative or a friend, whosoever you feel is a well-wisher of the child. And ideally, one from maternal side, one from paternal side, so that you can decide the trust in a way, define it. The money that you have, the asset, goes prudently to your children. Now, you may have more than one children, one is disabled, another not. It gets prudently distributed among themselves to ensure that the child is taken care of when, even when you're not there.
Right. You also talked about that, you know, mutual funds or equity mutual funds are probably a good way to invest in for future if you have a long time horizon when you're planning for your children's education or for marriage as well. So if you could tell me your suggestions or your recommendations, where should the parents be looking at and what are the things they should be looking at when they go out to invest in a mutual fund?
Okay, if you're spending time to understand which funds are good funds, then can you actually look at those kind of funds. So you can have a multi-cap fund or a mid-cap and a small-cap fund in your portfolio. And but if you do not want to have take any risk and you do not have any understanding about where to invest,
right,
you can simply invest in an index fund. that will give you a broader perspective of the market, and you actually will carry a market willing to return to your product.
Right, absolutely. Now, this is as far as what we've understood as to what should parents be doing as far as financial planning for children goes. Now, I want to focus more on the children really, as to how should parents begin teaching their child about financial planning, how early should they start doing it, and how early money lessons for children really help going in the long run.
It's a very, it's interesting. In fact, all parents grapple here a lot.
Yeah.
So,
I think dilemma is the parent's middle name, you know.
Absolutely. And especially with nuclear family and you have one or two child.
Yeah.
And most often our weekends are spent in the malls.
Yes.
Okay. So, there is a tendency of saying yes to things when especially you have got one or two child.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, let me break this into three concepts. One is the concept of money that you should imbibe on the children. Second is awareness, and third is literacy.
Right.
So literacy is a little far away. So as a young children, when the children are in the growing stage, so below 12, so there the concept of instant versus delayed gratification should be explained. So for example, there should be a concept of saying no to a child also.
Yes.
That yes, everything we cannot buy immediately. There should be, that teaches a child patience. And this is one of the big problem the current millennials are facing, because they want instant gratification.
Oh yes.
So that is what possibly will be one. Secondly, introducing the concept of money, introducing a concept of actually saving. So how, in fact, what I have done to my son is basically given him a pocket allowance.
Yeah, monthly, okay.
And I told him, if you are able to save, say for example, if I'm giving him say simplicity, say 1,000 rupees, and I'm saying if you're able to save even 200 rupees, the next month I will give you 1,000 rupees, but I'll do a matching grant of 200 rupees.
Okay, because you've been able to save that.
And that 200 rupees goes
into his... So you reward for saving.
Yes, reward for saving. That 200 goes into his Kotak savings bank account, which I've opened.
Okay.
The savings bank account with a debit card is fine, interesting.
Okay.
So you introduced him to the concept of savings bank account.
Okay.
And savings also, which is actually a problem at times.
Right.
With a lot of youngsters.
Yeah.
So was introducing him into that concept. Before, much younger when he was, I introduced him to the concept of money, showing him what kind of different denominations of money and how it is helped. So now he's gone into a teenage, we're trying to introduce him this, apart from saving, the concept of budgeting.
Right.
So I've asked my wife to introduce him how the budgeting is done. So the concept of budgeting is getting introduced to him.
Right.
He knows ki, okay, in a month I need to budget it all. This is an earlier education that I'm giving to him. Introducing him how he can start gradually savings also, investing. More importantly, telling you what are the good and the bad side of money.
Exactly.
For example, loans, credit cards. So as a parent also, we do not encourage. So all our consumer goods, all bought upfront, not an EMI.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Alam, for sharing all those insights with us. Well, hope this conversation has been fruitful and useful to all our viewers as well. Many thanks for watching, and do send your feedback and comments on Money Control PF at nw18.com.